Good Monday morning, One Life America. Today kicks off the month of December. Glad you could all take a few minutes to join us for our call. I hope everybody had a great Thanksgiving weekend. For some of us, we decided we might need to do some exercising after some overindulging for the entire weekend. Everyone's line is muted and will be muted through the entire call until the very end portion where we'll have a question and answer session. Looking forward to our two guest speakers this morning. Your purpose of the phone call is just to get plugged in, start your week off right, get some good information, and head into a full week of activity. Hopefully a lot of sales are involved for everyone this week. Our guest speaker for our devotion this morning is Mr. Adam Stewart. He's sitting beside me and doing a little coughing, so hopefully he can make it through. His whole family unfortunately suffered some illness, so hopefully he'll be okay, and he's got a bottle of water here with him, so he'll be okay for the entire meeting. Adam is our Director of Agent Onboarding and Retention and has worked for One Life for about 3.5 years. Many of you might have spoken directly with Adam in the getting started phase with One Life. Christian, family man, devoted employee, athlete, and outdoorsman are just a few things that pop into my mind when I think of Adam Stewart. So Adam's here to kick us off with our devotion this morning. Go ahead, Adam.
Thanks, David. As we're just finishing the Thanksgiving time of the year, you know, it's often a time of the year where everybody, you know, reflects on what they have to be thankful for. And, you know, I'd like to just start off by saying I'm, you know, extremely thankful for this company and for our leadership and the people that are in places of leadership, our ownership team, and, you know, what a great place that they have created for us to work, and just the family atmosphere. That's something that you really don't find a lot these days. So, you know, obviously that's something I'm very thankful for. But, you know, another thing when I think about Thanksgiving is leftovers. My family is very large. We have a large family, and every year at Thanksgiving we have roughly 40 people at a family member's house, and it's gotten so big that we have to do it outside in my aunt and uncle's barn. They have a big, nice barn, and it's heated, and we have our Thanksgiving lunch there. And when you have 40 people, roughly, everybody brings a lot of dishes, a lot of great food, and it's one of those times of the year where everybody wants to fix a plate of leftovers to take home because the food's so good. And I know at my house, you know, we'll typically take home enough leftovers to last 2 days, and we enjoy that because it's only one time of the year where we get to eat a lot of that the food that we have at that event. But, you know, in life, typically leftovers are something that we don't look at as a good thing. You know, I had an older brother growing up, so, you know, I got the hand-me-down clothes, and, you know, when he was 13 months older than me, so we were real close in age, so when he got his driver's license, he got a car, and, you know, 2 years later, he got a new one. Well, I got the hand-me-down car, you know. So we often look at leftovers as something that's not good. And one thing that I have to admit that I'm guilty of a lot of time is giving God leftovers in my life, whether that be my time or my efforts. And, you know, the Bible is very clear. There's two verses that I've kind of combined, Proverbs 3:9 and Matthew 6:33. Tell us to honor God with everything that we have, to give him the first and to give him the best of what we have. And if we do those, that he'll provide for us the things that we need. So my challenge to each person is, as we're in that time of the year, you know, we're always busy. But this time of the year, we especially get busy with just the things of life, of work and the holidays. And my encouragement to you would be to make sure you carve out time to give God the best of what you have and not to give him what's left over. And I believe that if we do that, that he'll bless us in that. So if you would, please just let me lead us in a quick prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day. Father, we thank you for this company. Father, I thank you for each person that took the time out of their schedule to be on this call. And Lord, we just ask that you would be with each one, that you would bless their time this week, Father, and that you would help them be productive in their work and that you would bless their work. And Father, we pray that you would help each of us to carve out that time to make an effort to be intentional, to give you a portion of our time, Lord, and to commit that to you. And Father, we ask that you would just be with us in everything that we do and say. We pray that you would be with our agents as they travel this week, that you would just watch over them as they travel to their various towns where they're going to work. And Father, again, we thank you for your son, Jesus, who died on the cross to forgive us of our sins. And it's in your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Adam. Yeah, good to be reminded that Thanksgiving is not just a day in November. It should be every day of our lives. Whether good, bad, or ugly, there's always things to be thankful for. Jumping into some marketing highlights, we kick off our fourth quarter cash contest today. We affectionately call this our Christmas Cash Contest. It runs from today through production that is submitted or written through December the 15th. There's incentives. It's a two-week total production contest, so anywhere from $10,000 of total production in those 2 weeks up to $25,000 plus receives a bonus. And I'll send that an email reminder here in a few minutes when we finish the call with the actual PDF of the contest. You can see each level from $10,000 to $25,000. You can win $100 at $10,000 of production, all the way up to a $1,000 bonus if you submit $25,000 plus in the two-week total contest time. So get ready for that. 2 weeks of run and gun, extra cash for the Christmas holidays will be fantastic. Our production update, this is for week 11-17 through 11-21. As an agency, we submitted $440,664.48 of submitted annual premium. Top agent for that week, none other than Chris Reed from right here in Meridian, Mississippi, with $10,966.20 of submitted annual premium. Timothy McCabe submitted $10,332.12. Imogene Jackson, $8,671. Kirsten Goodman, $7,610. Guys, this is on the heels of her crushing the rookie fast start record. She is still rolling. Shane Burnett comes in at fifth place at $7,101 of submitted premium. James Little Jr., $6,976 of submitted premium. Jason Kyle, $6,958 of submitted premium. William Russell, $6,900 of submitted premium. Lawrence Jones Jr., $6,545 of submitted premium. And Nigel Johnson rounds out the top 10 at $6,318 of submitted annual premium. Make sure to stop by and visit the online apparel store, onelife.geigershops.com, onelife.geigershops.com. This is where you're going to get your One Life polos. I'm wearing one of them right now. One Life long sleeve shirts, men's and women's, different colors, great stuff. So if you want to represent One Life while you're in the field, you can do it for winter with long sleeves or summer with short sleeves, but you can do that at onelife.geigershops.com. Great prices and great shirts. We have our text message solution, which is texting OLA to the number 51660 to make sure you opt in to our text message group and get important updates, especially a reminder of this conference call every Monday morning. We did a contest through the month of November, and everybody that opted into our group entered for a chance to win a $100 gas card, and that winner should be announced at 11:30 Central Time today. There'll be a blast text message that goes out, and then you'll be prompted to call in to redeem your card. So we're looking forward to having that. I appreciate everybody making that a success by joining in our text message group. The way you stay connected at One Life, text message option also. Then you have our One Life conference calls, which I appreciate you all being on. Our Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and LinkedIn. Please take time to visit there, see holiday pictures, see important information, contest winners, contest announcements. Our Facebook page has a contest announcement on there for the Christmas Cash Contest. It's a good place to view that as well. Make sure that you check out Derek Moore's Monday Motivational Minute. He posted it today, and I believe it's I for Innovation. He's back in his alphabetical series. So I for Innovation. So go to onelifeamerica.com/Derek Moore to check out his Monday Motivational Minute video. The Academy kicks off 1 week from today. You still have time to get your new agents registered, or if you are a new agent and you haven't registered, to get registered in for our Academy. Starts on Monday, December the 8th at 1 o'clock here at the corporate office in Meridian, Mississippi. We're excited. We have a fantastic group building right now. This promises to be the best that we've put on so far, especially this year. So we're looking forward to this Academy. Please get your folks registered if they are not. I want to jump in now to our main portion of our phone call, which we're very fortunate to have Mr. Justin White join us today. Justin White began his insurance career in 2000 after two degrees and an early career as a professional opera singer. The past 14 years, he has spent building agencies, insurance agencies, and field forces, training agents, and nurturing a passion for solving problems using insurance. From 2000 to 2008, he was a founding branch manager with Futurity First Insurance Group, where he won multiple production, recruiting, and training awards. He opened another branch between 2008 and 2009, and he was the number one life insurance branch with that organization when he left. 2009 to 2011, he founded 10 Group Financial Services. He will complete his CLU certification in the next 6 weeks, and he is now a partner with niche marketing market insurers and a division manager with One Life America. And we're very honored to have Mr. Justin White on the call with us today to share some knowledge. Justin, are you with us?
I am here. Good morning, David. Good morning, One Life.
Good morning, Justin. Thanks for joining us, and take it away.
Hey, absolutely. My pleasure. Listen, a second ago I got disconnected, so get your pencil. If I get disconnected again, I will call back on another line starting with 281-451. But hopefully that will not be necessary, folks. I just want to tell you how pleased I am to be here today. I'm very honored to be asked to come in, and I don't know how many questions my talk is going to actually generate. This is really more for introspection than anything, and this is a great season for this. And I am so delighted with the Christian focus of One Life. It just makes so many. It just makes it easier to talk about certain things because you can go to the source of all knowledge, which is Scripture. And Hosea 4:6 says that my people are destroyed or perish for lack of knowledge. And throughout my career, and this is the topic of my, you know, that's the topic of my talk today, is basically knowledge of what we do. I firmly believe that the biggest mistake made by agents, one of them, but one of it's up there and it's not talked about a lot, is the fact that so many agents know very little past generalities in what it is that they're doing. And, you know, in other words, do you know, how much do you know about the policies that you sell beyond the little blurb that goes out that, that the clients and everybody gets, you know, the little outline of the coverages and what they do? And unfortunately, a lot of agents kind of stop there. And if you know as much as your clients, potentially, I submit to you that that's an issue. And as again, example, if you went into a doctor, for example, to go see somebody, you're ill and not feeling well, you are not going to be happy if that doctor kind of knows a little bit about medicine. They're like, yeah, I'm pretty good at it. And, you know, I've gotten good at it through the years, and I let me take a shot at this. It's not going to make you feel very good. Same thing with a mechanic. You take your Volvo in to somebody to work on it, and they say, yeah, you know, I'm familiar with what the Volvo is. I've never worked on one, but, yeah, let me take a crack at that engine. That's going to make you feel less than comfortable. And, unfortunately, that's what a lot of agents do. There's a difference in being good in sales and being a true professional at your craft. And so what I would submit and throw out there is, as an agent, you know, are you good? Are you riding a God-given reservoir of talent to make your sales? And at the same time, if you are, that's wonderful, but are you using that talent to strive more towards becoming an actual professional at your craft? For example, do you delve into policy detail? Do you look at just, I mean, people would call it the minutia, but I mean, do you know more about the policy that you sell on a regular basis than the person who trained you? If you don't, I would submit to you that you probably should. Now, I'm not saying that you want to be so wrapped up in this that you do not go out and get active. This is an on-the-job type of learning. It is something to where, you know, you should be paying careful attention to your study and looking at what you're selling, but do it in the evenings or do it in the weekends, and you're going to be out in the field learning about it. When a client asks you a question, be genuinely curious about what it is, if it has to do with a waiting period or has to do with a particular writer. If you know the answer, good for you. If you don't, be genuinely curious about finding out what it is, because it's going to absolutely set you apart from everybody else that's out there, because I can't believe how many times I run into agents and they're like, you know, past the basic outline, they can answer very few questions. So in looking at final expense, hopefully you guys have a pad of paper and a pencil. I have a question for you, and that question would be this. Knowing what I know about my level of knowledge and study, would I do business with me? I asked myself that question a while back, and, you know, a few years ago, and I didn't like the answer that came back because I knew that I was not an expert. I did not have a sufficient amount of knowledge that I would personally demand from somebody, and I probably would not have paid much attention to what I knew. Now, again, folks, don't say, oh, I've got to learn this, and now I don't know enough to go out. That would be a mistake. You've got to go be active and while you're on the job. But I want you to think about that. Do you take time to read about the stuff that you're selling so that you know more than anybody else that you know? Now, let's take a look at some numbers that I think you'll find very interesting, because I believe that life insurance is the number one biggest opportunity in industry, in the sales industry right now in the United States. And I'm going to prove it to you by going to some numbers that are put out by the organization LIMRA. It's the Life Insurance Marketing and Research Association. They do a survey every single year, and these surveys have actually become famous in recent years. Things like Trillion Dollar Baby Grows Up, the life insurance barometer studies that they've now done for the last several years. And what they do is they'll go and call somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,000 or more people and ask them about their life insurance buying habits. This is the general public getting a cold call. And what they said, I think, will surprise you, and it puts a little bit of my point in play. 89% of the American public says that final expense, having enough money for final expenses, is the main reason to own a life insurance policy. Almost 90%, 9 in 10 people say that. At the same time, a number between 80 and 85% of all Americans say that everyone should own a policy, just as a matter of course. So those numbers are almost identical, but here's the kicker. Only 60% of the population actually do own a life policy. Now, why the discrepancy? 9 in 10 say, oh my gosh, final expense is very important, why you should own one. 85% say everybody should have one, those are in agreement, and then only 60% actually do. So they're not walking the walk. Now, there's a lot of opinions that go around about this, but I personally believe that is a deficit of confidence in the industry. Now, again, I'm not here to bash our industry per se, or us, or anything, or you, certainly, with this, but this is about just having the conversation and talking about the tough things. A deficit of confidence, why do I say that? Well, because the excuses that they give for not buying are very telling. A lot of them say, oh, it's too expensive. That is the number one. I've got other financial priorities. And I'm sitting here thinking, priorities above your family, above your kids. No, there's something that doesn't sound right about that. There's another excuse that says, well, I just haven't gotten around to it. Good old procrastination. Well, again, when you're talking about pass away, that they're not burdened with something, it still doesn't ring true. My personal favorite is the third one, where they say, well, I haven't done it because it's too hard to know how much I need. And I'm like, well, there's a reason for that. It's because it's not your job. It's the agent's job. And so when you're using things like dignity planning, which y'all do, where you can dial into the actual costs to show the actual needs, it's just very, very important. Now, why the deficit of confidence? Well, I would submit to you that it's because so many people have gotten used to agents coming by that can't answer those basic questions. The agent shows that they don't understand how to figure out how much somebody needs. Or somebody watches television and watches the various commercials that come on and sees the bait and switch that go on in today's advertising. And they get bad tastes in their mouth by what they think they're going to get versus what ends up showing up. So as an agent, another question for you, do you know more about your hobby than you do your profession? You men, fantasy football, a lot of guys following that, and ladies, you know, with exercise knowledge and things like that, do you know more information about your hobby than you do what you're using to support your family? Everybody knows that sales can be a challenge, and there's a success rate that is far below how many people try. There's a lot of reason, you know.
All right, folks, it looks like we might have lost Mr. Justin White. He did let us know there that he would dial back in. So we're going to give him a few minutes. It might take him a second to realize that he's actually dropped the call. He might be talking at the moment. I do appreciate what he's saying, you know, creating a need, showing the need for the product and our services and what we offer, and then informing your clients so that they understand exactly what they're purchasing and have the knowledge to know when they get that policy in the mail what they're looking at and what they actually purchased from you. This is, you know, I'll just touch on this real quick while we're waiting on Justin to jump back on the call. We have a replete university online information you can go on to, product-specific, carrier-specific information. You can learn about each company that we offer in our portfolio of products, all their products that they offer individually, standard, modified, graded, the benefits of, you know, obviously going to the carrier's respective websites and learning the products themselves there is always a good tool to use. Our academy, I mentioned earlier, is coming up next week, and we dive off into that as well. But having the knowledge to know what you're selling and what your clients' needs are, and then showing them the need for that. And Justin mentioned, you know, that the he named a few different points there of excuses that some folks use, and one being not knowing how much they need. Well, you can show them that, obviously. You know, different scenarios. There's a top 10 list. The excuses are they're never changing. That's why we have a top 10 objections and rebuttals list, because there's going to be certain excuses that people use to put this off another day. Procrastination, he meant. I mentioned, and procrastination, saying, you know, I just hadn't had time to do it, or whatever the case might be. We're looking for Justin to jump back in on the call here. And
somebody else call back in with a different number.
281 number.
867.
Okay. We're going to unmute a line here and see if this happens to be Justin. Starts with an 860. Is that you, Justin? Nope, that was not Justin. We'll give him a couple more minutes here. While we're doing that, I'm going to have Jonathan turn the lines to a Q&A session where you can actually star mute. Go ahead and change that line over. If anybody has anything they'd like to share on objections and rebuttals, go ahead and unmute yourself with star 6, and you can unmute yourself and share with us. KT, did you unmute your line?
Yes, I did. Did you say you wanted questions, or what did you ask?
Well, we're just kind of in a pause mode, waiting for Justin to dial back in. If you had anything to share on objections and rebuttals, and it's kind of what Justin was covering, knowing your products, knowing what you're out there promoting while you're in the field. Do you have anything to add to that, KT?
I think he's dead on. He's spot on as far as what he's saying, as far as the importance of understanding what we actually sell. And that's something that I'm going to be implementing to my team, is to not just rely on me to give them the education that they need, but them to do the due diligence. And like, you know, like you said, off time is, or non-peak time is, any time after 9 p.m. In the evening, Monday through Friday, and then you have Saturday and Sunday. So what I'm going to encourage, you know, my team to do is to, you know, just take one product and just read it, and then that way, once you read it and you have any questions that I can help answer, that's going to help you understand the product more. But I think for me, is the people, agents understanding what the underwriting guide is. And, you know, that's pretty much, I consider like the equivalent to the Bible for the insurance industry and learning, you know, the underwriting guide so where it can help you on different situations, and that way you know when it comes up that you have read it before or you saw it before, and it doesn't eliminate you for not being what we call a professional. So that's the key thing, is you being able to know and understand when a client tells you, I'm taking this medication, or when a client say, yeah, this happened a year ago, and you knowing that, yeah, I saw this before, or it comes to your recollection that, yeah, I know that this particular situation won't be a problem or will be a problem, and all we need to do is to make a call to the underwriter to get more clarification on what to do versus saying, no, I can't help you. So that's one of the keys that I always look at. Before I say, no, I can't help you, I always want to go through my ABCs of the underwriter guide first, and then if that doesn't help, I always make a call to the underwriter to see, if I submitted this application, how would the results be? Would it be favorable or would it be not favorable? So that's another key thing that I always encourage agents to do before you just say no because of certain condition, you know, especially if it was on less than a year ago or less than 2 years, or even if it was more than 6 years ago, that may be a situation where it may be considered and may be acceptable. And that has happened for me in certain cases when it has been over 6 years or longer, and the client may be just taking a maintenance drug to keep them, you know, steady, but it may not actually decline them on a normal status where it was less than a certain amount of years, it will be declined. So I think one of the key things is to learn and what the underwriting guide can do for you, and it's kind of your best friend.
Absolutely, KT. And that underwriting guide, carrier to carrier, is different. Some are all-inclusive. Some are individual pieces. The underwriting guideline, which is a full explanation of the product itself. Then there's the prescription guide, which lets you know if they take a particular medication, you know, what plan they will qualify for, as well as a health scenario guide or a health issue guide. So if they tell you inside of this particular time window, I've experienced this health challenge, you know what product to go with each respective carrier. So you're absolutely right. Knowing those, not just knowing it, but having it with you, having it on your person so that you can go to that. And it's always a good idea when you're faced with an uncertainty when you're sitting in front of a client. It's okay to call the carrier. It's okay to call and ask a question and get. You want to be able to leave that house and them receive in the mail what you told them they were going to get, not a reduced policy. And it's going to happen because they're going to do MIB and script checks, but to leave that house and then receive a policy with exactly what you told them they were going to receive is very beneficial, and it's very difficult to go back and to resell that if you have to. So it's always good to know your stuff. Do we have Justin in by chance? Justin very well could be still talking, not realizing his phone had dropped the call. So it doesn't look like we're going to get Justin back on this call. We do appreciate him joining us for the call, but you know, here in the first 5 minutes of his conversation with us, it's knowing your product, knowing what you're doing, knowing how to present the product, knowing how to overcome objections and rebuttals, and being a master in your craft. 1 second. Okay, we're going to unmute a line. This could be Justin White jumping back on. Justin, are you with us?
Hey, buddy. Man, when did I drop off? I was sitting there talking to a crescendo to finish up and realized nobody was there.
Justin, we have not had you on the call for quite some time.
Golly. I apologize. I apologize. I have no idea. Maybe it's the weather. We got a front blowing through down here. But, you tell me what you want to do.
Just go back into, you'd covered, you know, the procrastination. Somewhere after that, within a, you know, 45 seconds to a minute after that is about where we lost you. So if you can just jump back in there, even if you repeat yourself, it's perfectly fine. We're all here listening.
Well, I appreciate that, and I apologize. You know, guys, the bottom line is the public wants life insurance. The public knows how important life insurance is. And the information that they're giving, when they say I'm procrastinating, another one that they say is I don't know, it's too hard to figure out how much I need, which of course is the agent's job. And so they're coming in saying they're giving excuses that are not valid, and what the reason that I say that it's a deficit of confidence is because, that's exactly what it is. They're giving excuses that don't make any sense, and yet they're saying, oh, my goodness, everybody should have coverage, and they should have it primarily for final expense. And the deficit of confidence is coming down to the fact that a lot of the agents that are out there working right now cannot answer basic questions about what they do beyond the outline for the policy that they have. And I would ask just a general question to the field right now is how many of you know more information, more detail about your hobby than you do about your profession? You know, if I ask a lot of the men on the call about fantasy football, if you go into a lot more minutia and detail about that than you can about the policies that you're out there selling to people to protect their families than that. And so, and ladies, you know more about an exercise program or, you know, just whatever it is that people get into for their hobbies and things. And unfortunately, there's a lot of people that would answer that affirmatively. And that should not be, that just should not be the case. So one thing I tell people to do is ask yourself, knowing what you know about your level of knowledge and your level of study, would you do business with you? And that's not, it's not to condemn anybody at all. What it is just, I asked myself that question several years ago, and the answer was not great. I was thinking, you know what? I don't know enough about this. Somebody asked me a question, and I can't always answer the thing. And as I said, that doesn't mean you study and you stop being active until you know everything about a policy. Don't do that. This is something you learn on the job. It's an ongoing process. Do that in the evening, on the weekends, at night, you know, whatever it is, so that you can study during the times that you're actually down and learn on the job while you're in the field and develop a general curiosity for what you do. And I tell people this, and you can kind of write down this little timeline, knowledge creates an awareness, a deeper awareness of the problem that you solve. So if you study what you do, you're going to become more aware of the problems that you actually solve. And when you're aware of the problems, especially as Christians, you're going to develop a personal mission to solve it. There's one of those problems that you're going to become really kind of attuned to, and you're going to develop a personal mission to solve that. And when you do that, you're going to start noticing passion is going to rise. You're going to get excited when you're able to do that. Passion always leads to more activity because you now have a mission. You know what you're trying to do. You reach out there and get it rolling. So passion leads to activity, and activity inevitably and always will lead to sales, referrals, et cetera, because it's going, you know, because you're going to stand out. So how do you stand out? What are some ways that you can stand out when you are going into the field? And I'll just kind of go through these things quickly since we're at our disaster this morning. But have you gone by funeral homes in your area to talk to the directors and state your needs? Have you gone by and literally met them and say, hey, I'm not here to sell anything today. I just want to come in and say, I'm so-and-so with One Life America. Here's what we do. We want to make sure that every single person coming in here, their families have got money to pay for your services. And we do that through a final expense policy and offer to help them get word out about their particular facility in the area. Say, I live here. I want to develop a partnership with you. Do you know their rate? Do you know the rate of their competition? Do you know the names of these people by their name so you can drop them in a appointment? I was talking to Sammy Jones the other day. You know, he owns the XYZ funeral home down the street, and he was telling me da-da-da-da-da. It's going to make them go, oh, wow, you're really dedicated to what you do. And it's going to make them remember you. It's going to make them remember you more than somebody else. It's going to make it look like you care more than the other guy that came by that was just trying to sell him a $10,000 policy and didn't have the types of information that you do. Do you send cards, birthday, Christmas, whatever, to every single one of your clients? They remember those. Do you send a thank you note? Even when they don't close, one thing, that's a trick that a lot of people don't get. When you go do an appointment and they don't close, send a thank you note for them sitting down. You'll be surprised at how many times you're going to get a call back that's going to say, you know what, thank you so much. They're going to keep that when they do actually want to buy it, they're going to call you back. So cards, believe me, they remember it. It makes them think of you several times a year, and you will get referrals. If you're not doing that now and you're getting referrals, start sending the cards and see what happens. Finally, do you do annual calls? I've seen a lot of your all's, you know, I've seen a lot of your all's production, and some of you guys write hundreds of policies in a year. Do you call 10 of them a day throughout the course of the year and just say, hey, I was thinking about you today. How are you doing? How's that, you know, take notes about them. Remember that they had heart surgery, you know, 2 years before you went. I know you had heart surgery. How are you feeling? They're going to impress them. And whenever you call, something's going to come up. It's more often than you think. They're going to want more. They're going to want to add some coverage, or they're going to say, you know, I need to talk to you about my son. You know what? My next-door neighbor, she's sitting right here. Talk to her. And you're going to get a lot of freebies just simply by standing out to do that. So to circle back around on this, knowledge is going to set you apart. Do not be that person that can't answer a basic question about your policy. Just don't be that person. You want to develop the awareness of the problems. You want to develop a personal mission. You want that to develop into passion. You want that to automatically, you don't, it actually doesn't develop, it just happens. You become more active, and activity always results in sales, referrals, et cetera. So in coming back to, you know, this wonderful question, knowing what you know about your level of knowledge and your study of your business, of your craft, would you do business with you? And don't be afraid to ask that question. If the answer is no, just start doing something about it. Be an expert. Jim Mall is the best example of somebody that's an expert in this business that I've seen in a long time. A lot of your trainers are experts in the business. That's why they're training. Why can't you strive to become more knowledgeable than the people who teach you, to where you can then become the teacher, and you will find yourself with a career that is in a different, going into a different level. And it is, you just absolutely will be unstoppable. So as Hosea says, 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Ask yourself those questions and start making moves to rectify it, and you're going to be very, very pleased with what happens. And, David, that's my circle back around, and I don't know if there'd be any questions. Hopefully we had some people, you know, hang on, but that's all I got.
We did. We did, Justin. Thank you so much for being on there. You know, if it wasn't, you know, we're going to have technical challenges from time to time, but we did fill in the gaps there with a little back and forth talk, and KT joined in to share some insight with us as well. Everybody's still set to where you can *6 to unmute yourself. If you have any questions for Justin White, this is a guy that's trained hundreds and thousands of agents. So if you, and I've actually been on one of his conference calls before. Very impressed with Justin and his ability. So if you have any questions while Justin's on the phone, now is a great time to do that. Go ahead and *6 and unmute yourself. Justin, I think in summation, you're basically saying to go the extra mile, take an extra step, put in the extra effort of learning, educating yourself, knowing the particular products, knowing the insurance industry as a whole life insurance as a whole, and then your craft, and going that extra step to prepare yourself and not just go out and write policies this week and go home and say, I'm through, but when you have some downtime, spend some extra time. A lot of people sit in a shoot house in a deer field, or they're riding in the passenger seat of the car while they're going on a trip, or a lot of different times where there's opportunities to do some educational insight and learn a little bit more about your craft. Is there any questions for Justin? I'm sorry, Justin.
No, I just can say I'm always surprised at how many times I'll be working with an agent. Somebody, an agent will call and say, man, I can't get anything going. And I will talk with them. And again, it's tough love in a way. I will talk with them and ask them a few questions and find out that a lot of the reason that they can't get anything going is that they don't have a very solid understanding of why and what they're selling. And so they're going out there and running into doing a presentation, and they're lacking credibility because there's not a passion or a back belief. They just have something that they're wanting to sell to make money without an understanding of what the reason is, the underlying reasons and knowledge of what it is that they're trying to accomplish. And that's oftentimes all it is.
Absolutely. Any questions for Justin while we have him on the phone? All right, Justin, thanks again for joining our call. We really appreciate you being on today. want to remind everybody that the Academy is coming up, so you've got time to get your agents registered. Or if you're a new agent, you haven't registered and haven't been to an Academy, there's no time like the present. Go ahead and get registered. Starts a week from today at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time here at our corporate office in Meridian. Go confidently in the direction of your dreams. Thanks, One Life, for joining the call, and everybody have a fantastic week. Goodbye.